is Action Sports Jax Jags Report Live from Strings Sports Brewery, sponsored by Farrah & Farrah, the exclusive injury law firm of the Jaguars.
Obviously, we've lost some games here, right? So we want to change that culture to a winning culture. That's why we coach and that's why we play.
A lot of harsh words yesterday by the Jacksonville Jaguars. Doug Peterson talked about the fact that they got to fix the culture. Andre Sisco, you see running off the field, said the team quit. We got to break it all down. The Jaguars are staying over in London. That's probably a good thing because they wouldn't want to watch these next 30 minutes, ladies and gentlemen. It's not going to be a pretty sight. It might be midnight at Big Ben over there in London, but it's midnight here in Jacksonville, too, as the Jaguars are 1-5. Hi, everybody. Dan Hicken live at Strings, ready to talk Jaguar football for the next 30 minutes. Love being out here each and every Monday night. And looky who we got, my man, Tommy Mac. Tommy McManus in the house tonight.
Thank you.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you. Great to be here.
Great to have
you.
Let's show him the resume of Tommy McManus. Tommy McManus has had Tom Coughlin his whole football life, man. He was at Boston College. He looked up in the NFL, and there was Tom Coughlin again. You love that. You love that, Tom McManus.
You know what? He came into my life in 1991, and, man, I love that guy. He's one of my favorite people in the entire world.
All right. Well, he's not around right now in terms of coach of the team. It's Doug Peterson. We got to dive into this thing, but we got breaking news to start the show with, right? We learned today, and the question that I'll ask you after I tell everybody, Roy Robertson Harris traded for a late draft pick, a sixth rounder in 2026. Wow, they've signed him twice to two different contracts, and he's gone for a sixth rounder. I guess my question to you, Tommy, is this the start of something that's going to start happening here? Are we going to be dealing and wheeling and getting rid of a lot of guys?
Well, it's kind of odd because, A, he's been kind of producing. B, you extended him in the offseason.
Yeah.
And, you know, now you're going to ship him off. It just doesn't make a whole lot of sense for a six-round draft pick, future draft pick.
Yeah.
I don't know, man. I hope it's not that. I hope we're not giving in just yet. We got to keep fighting. This ain't over just yet. You know what I mean? I mean, 1-5's awful.
Yeah.
Everybody's unhappy about it. But, Hick, as you know, we've been 2-6. We've been 3-6.
Yeah.
You're not too far from there. Hopefully you can get some things going and get on a run, maybe.
All right, Tommy, you're the expert. I'm not when it comes to football.
I'm not an expert.
X's and O's, you understand it. I don't. But
okay.
I see things and I have to ask questions. And I saw some things yesterday that frankly shocked me. And I know this about football. And I can tell you this, and I'll talk to Tony Boselli. I'll talk to you. I know that in football, when you're playing football, you sprint until the play's over.
Oh, yeah.
You may be going the wrong way, but you sprint. I saw Tony Boselli chase down a defensive back against Archel Hawkins of the Cincinnati Bengals. I saw him chase Otis Smith in the AFC Championship game. He might not have caught him, but he chased him. It's a big man. You always sprint until the play's over, right? Isn't that part of football?
Yeah, you're supposed to.
Okay, so let's show you a play from yesterday. And again, we're going to pick on everybody, but this is a good play call. Nice play design. Fake one way, fake the other way.
Yep.
Now watch 33. We're going to show it a few times. But see my man 33 right there?
I don't.
That's not sprinting, Tom.
Well, no, it's not at all. But first and foremost, that's his man.
He got confused
by all the razzle-dazzle that they did, and he should have been looking at his man, who was number three to his side. He's the dime backer, and he should not have been fooled. That's number one. And then number two, man, you're not running to the ball. Do they do pursuit drills in practice? Because we used to do them, and everyone moaned and groaned about them, but they were very important because you run to the football every single snap.
On the left side of the screen, 41's not booking it either, man. I mean, you got to get after these guys. Everybody's got to run to the ball on the defensive side. The defense is ranked way low. They're like 31st in scoring. They're the worst pass defense in the NFL. What is going on with this defense, Tom McManus?
Well, I tell you, a few times, because I watch the tape on Monday mornings. It takes me about 3 hours from the house. I just like watch. I write every play down, and there's too many mental errors again. I mean, Lloyd is not only out of position, he misses his man. Both those Komet touchdowns, it was his guy, and he's nowhere near him, and I don't understand it. Now, I'll tell you this. The one that Komet ran the seven route in the end zone, he was pretty much wide open. They were playing man, but the outside guy came in underneath, and I think he thought it was zone, and he jumped him. And you're not supposed to jump him when you're in man. You got to keep the guy that is coming up the field, and that was Komet. So I don't know, man. It's guys that are out of focus. I mean, Darby was bad. Armstead doesn't seem to be doing much. Lloyd's out of position. I tell you, it's time for guys to sit down. The question is, will the brass have the balls to do it?
I think sometimes, too, and I don't know this. I'll get your opinion. Ryan Nielsen, the defense coordinator, he promised us an attacking man-to-man defense. They all say that. It's the same stuff from every defensive coordinator. But, boy, we play a lot of guys on the defensive line. We play a lot of guys. And then sometimes I'll look up in big situations, and I'll look for 44 and 41 because, frankly, they're the only two pass rushers we got, and they're getting a blow on the sideline. Why is that?
They should never come off the field. I know, listen, 11 play drives are long. You get tired.
I get
you
it.
You do. You need, might need a break here or there, but I agree with you. And another thing, you do so much rotation, you can't get into a rhythm as a player. I mean, as a backer, as a defensive lineman, you want to test your guy. You want to work on him. You want to see what you can do, what you can't do. Going two plays in, two plays out, all this stuff, you can't get into that kind of rhythm. So I don't get it, to be quite honest with you.
So something's got to happen. We'll see what it does. They're 1-5 right now. Brent Martineau was with the team every step of the way. He was interviewing Andre Sisco. Andre Sisco said the Q word. I want to ask you about that in just a second. But first, I want to bring in Brent, who's got the game plan for us from over there in London.
It's time for the game plan, sponsored by Everbank.
I don't think I have to describe Sunday's loss to the Chicago Bears. Everyone knows what it was like and saw what happened, and that includes everyone here on a Monday in London at the Jaguars team hotel. They are still smarting from a blowout loss and now 1-5 on the year. But what happened in the postgame on Sunday was notable. There were a lot of loud remarks by players and also head coach Doug Peterson, who said there's a culture change needed in Jacksonville. On Monday, he explained that further.
Even though we haven't won yet, I don't want them to feel sort of mentally defeated, if that makes sense, because that's where the slippery slope comes in, right? If you feel like you're going into a game where you don't have a chance, then you're not going to have a chance.
The headline comment came from safety Andre Sisco on Sunday when he said this to me in the locker room.
A lot of quit, and I don't know, just, you know, last line of defense, you know, in a situation like that, you could feel when we're playing is one, when we're not. And felt very early in the game, kind of once things kind of maybe at halftime, that we weren't playing as one.
On Monday, Peterson didn't think the words from Sisco would divide or combust the Jaguars locker room.
Obviously, it's his observation, but I don't think it was necessarily meant to harm anything or point a finger at anybody or anything like that.
And there was another comment that got our attention Sunday. Trevor Lawrence spoke about the team's inability to handle in-game adversity.
It's a long game. You know, I think as a team, like, we have to be, we can't be so fragile. You know, it's like, it's not going to go perfect every week.
Words don't usually fix a season gone wrong. Action does. And the only problem with that, we have to wait until Sunday against the New England Patriots at Wembley Stadium to find out if there is a fix. And speaking of waiting, we have team coverage here in London, England, on the Jaguars. And maybe they are waiting too long for someone else on the team to make a play.
So often when the results aren't showing up on the field, you try to look at a positive example of what went right. And for the Jaguars, you can only look at one game for that, against the Indianapolis Colts, when players were making big-time plays. Well, on Sunday against the Chicago Bears, that didn't happen, leaving us to question who's going to be the next guy to step up and make that big play when the Jaguars need it most.
We have the players, you know, that can do it. It's just doing it. And it's playing with that passion for all four quarters, not just spurts throughout the game. So, you know, just that's just part of, you know, what's going wrong right now.
I don't think necessarily people are chasing plays, but I think everyone, all 11, have to do their job on that play, on that individual play. You know, if there's 10 guys doing their job, one guy's not doing their job, that's when you see, you know, conversions. That's when you see offense staying on the field.
It's just a mentality, believing in each other, picking one another up, you know, supporting one another, realizing that we're all in this together, and go out there and you know, try to do what you can to be a reason why we win.
Just got to win. Win your play, win your matchup, win your job, win the game. That's just that simple, really. That's just not happening.
Looking at one position group in particular, help may be on the way in the form of the secondary, with Tyson Campbell returning from injury and Tayshawn Gibson possibly coming back from his 6-game suspension to start the season. Some veteran presence on the back end would certainly help the Jaguars' defense against a rookie quarterback and the New England Patriots. For Action Sports Jax, I'm Stuart Weber.
The Drive of the Day is sponsored by Ford F-Series. Test drive one at your local Ford dealer today.
All right, Tommy, I want to tell you this defense. You're playing hard. You got a little, you know, it's 21-10. Okay, we're back in the game. Trayvon makes a great play.
Yeah.
He does a smart thing here. He doesn't slam him down to get
strong.
A flag.
He's
we got fourth down. We're going to punt. No, we don't because we got 12 men on the field, Tom.
Yeah.
How can that happen?
I don't understand that. I mean, you should know what personnel groups you're in. You should know that. The coaches should know, too. I mean, I might put that one on the coaches a little bit because somebody from the sideline has got to be counting.
Well,
and if they're not counting, then they're going to miss it.
Looked like guys were not getting off the field fast, kind of jogging. Then we got a hold on. So that made it third and three. We get a hold on Darby.
Yep.
We got him in a third and 10. We get another stop. They're going to at least kick a field goal, but at least we stop them. And we got another hold. That's just, that kills you.
I tell you right there, I would have yanked Darby and sat him on the bench and said, enough's enough. Get somebody else in there that's not going to do that. In his defense, he's supposed to be this press corner. They keep playing off coverage. I don't think that's his game. Listen, what do you do when a guy's going to beat you? You tug a little bit so he doesn't get too far away from you. But if you get caught, you get caught. He got caught.
Caleb Williams, 4 touchdown passes yesterday for the Chicago Bears. And we're just warming up right here on Jags Report Live. We got Tommy McManus in the house. We're at Strings. We're having a good time, as best of time as we can have. We got to fix this thing. Shot. Stop with the vote of confidence, Shot. I've lost the faith, Shot. Got that coming up next.
This is Action Sports Jax, Jags Report Live from Strings Sports Brewery. Sponsored by Farrah & Farrah, the exclusive injury law firm of the Jaguars.
I mean, I'm confident that this team is going to meet the expectations. Okay, and the expectations, you know, we were talking about was maybe this season, but I'm talking about for the long term.
That was Jaguars owner Shad Khan Saturday when we had a chance to sit down with him here in London, expressing belief in the Jacksonville Jaguars despite a 1-4 start to the season. Welcome back, everybody, to the Jags Report Live. Strings Sports Brewery, the place to be each and every Monday night. More with Dan Hicken and Tom McManus coming up from Strings in Springfield in just a moment. But before we get to those guys, welcome back to London, England. In 2022, the Jacksonville Jaguars were a very resilient bunch. Remember, they started the season 3-7 and then rallied to make the postseason. They might need something special like that once again. So far, they just haven't responded to adversity or even the expectations of this 2024 season. Jags owner Shad Khan made a declaration back before training camp that he had high hopes and win-now mentality was in place here in Jacksonville. But so far, no good for the Jags.
Winning now is the expectation. This is the best team assembled by the Jacksonville Jaguars ever.
The Jaguars' on-field response to owner Shad Khan's expectations was a 1-4 start to the season. Yet the Jags owner told us Saturday here in London he still believed in this football team, not only this year, but the foundation was set for a long time to come.
You don't sign, some of these players. I mean, they're foundational players. We believe in them as the talent they are and the human beings they are.
We know how the NFL works. When you lose 5 out of 6 to end last season and 5 out of 6 to begin this season, the noise gets loud and the questions start coming about job security. Head coach Doug Peterson addressed that on Sunday after the game and said he fully believes he has the backing still of Jags owner Shad Khan. Always on the road with the Jacksonville Jaguars, this time in London, England. I'm Brent Martineau, Action Sports Jax.
All right, we're welcome back here at Strings. We got Tommy McManus. You just heard from Shad Khan, the owner. He's a patient guy, man, but I'm wondering if his patience is running out. What are your thoughts about what Shad Khan should do?
Well, that was Saturday.
Yeah.
that was before the game. He may be feeling something different right now. I mean, I know I would. I wouldn't be too happy. Look, I'm not big on firing. Because it doesn't look good on the organization.
Right.
If Shad Khan fires Doug Peterson now, it looks bad on him.
Yeah.
He goes to the owners' meetings, and all the other owners are like, what's going on? Why'd you fire your coach? You know, why can't you guys win? Why can't you get it together? So he is under the gun. Something's got to be done, but I think it's more internally with the players. I think you got to sit some guys. I think you got to knock their pride down a little bit, let them go home to their wives and girlfriends and their family and say, I'm not starting this week because I didn't perform well enough. But you got to have the backing of the owner because money comes involved, you know, politics get involved.
Oh, yeah.
You got to be able to do that. But I think something's got to be done like
you
that.
You said Shad Khan goes to the owners' meetings. Well, he's actually going to an owners' meeting tomorrow. He'll fly from London to Atlanta, where the NFL owners are expected to approve Jacksonville's plan for a stadium. That's a great thing for our city, obviously. Just your thoughts as a former player and seeing that, you know, this commitment, this long-term commitment from city and owner for the Jacksonville Jaguars to be the Jacksonville Jaguars forever.
Well, listen, I've been here longer than anywhere in my life. This is home for me. You know, my wife, my three daughters, we love it here. I think this is absolutely fantastic. It's going to be phenomenal for the city. It's going to be phenomenal for the organization. Now we just got to, you know, get the team together and win, and then it's going to explode. It's going to be absolutely phenomenal. But I think it's a great thing.
It is a great thing. Let's do this. Let's take a break. When we come back, I want to talk culture, and I want to get Tommy's opinion about culture and what's going on with the culture. And I have a suggestion, and I want him to tell me who can fix this problem, because obviously there is a problem when you're 1-5 and you're the most disappointing team in the NFL. That and more. We're live at Strings.
It's Action Sports Jacks, Jags Report Live from Strings Sports Brewery, sponsored by Farrah & Farrah, the exclusive injury law firm of the Jaguars.
All right, welcome back to Strings, man. We got some hardcore Jag fans hanging out with us here on a Monday night as we try to figure out what's going on with the Jacksonville Jaguars. Appreciate Tommy McManus coming in, former Jaguar linebacker, a guy who always gave his all on the football field. You maybe weren't the most talented, but you definitely played the game the way it's supposed to be played.
I feared for my job.
Yeah.
So Tom would have fired me if I didn't perform.
Right.
So I had to perform. It was all on me to perform.
All right, so I want to bring up something that I saw the other day. Now, this is, follow along with me. This is the National Hockey League, okay, everybody? Connor McDavid is thought of as the best player in the NHL. He plays for the Edmonton Oilers. The Edmonton Oilers made it to the Stanley Cup Finals this year against the Florida Panthers. Edmonton lost the first three games of the Stanley Cup Finals before winning the next three and then forcing a Game 7. But after the third straight loss, Connor McDavid had had enough.
Yep.
So this is Connor McDavid, and I'm hoping and praying that we beeped out all the bad words.
I hope you didn't.
But this is Connor McDavid in the locker room with his guys after the third straight loss in the Stanley Cup Finals. Take a listen, and then I'm going to ask Tommy some questions.
Right now. Right now. Right now. It's happened so many times.
And the point being, we're going to dig deep. This ain't good enough.
Yep.
We got to do better. Who on the Jags can do that for us?
That's
what Jaguar
question.
Player can go in that locker room after what we saw yesterday and do that?
Well, first of all,
it's not in Trevor's makeup.
Yeah. First of all, it's got to be a playmaker. It's got to be somebody that
who
makes
plays.
Who
has the respect of the locker room.
You know, if you think of like Trayvon Walker, if he seems quiet.
Quiet
but
guy.
But maybe he could not be quiet.
Okay.
He's a guy that guys would pay attention to.
Yeah.
I think Foye Aluakin would have the ears of
but
that
he's
locker
he's not playing
room.
Right now.
I know, but he still has, I think, their ear because he's a very well-respected individual. Maybe Morse, maybe Scherf. Maybe somebody that's been around a long time. Because it's got to come from within. It's not going to come from the coaching staff. It's not going to come from Doug. It's got to come from within that locker room. Just like we saw with that guy, Connerman. Made me want to run through some drywall.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know what I mean? No problem. Watch the studs, but go through the drywall. But you know what I mean? So it's got to come from within. Mm-hmm. And hopefully they can, because you got to, listen, at the end of the day, you got to hold each other accountable.
Right.
You have to. The stars, our stars always played well. Baselli, Smith, McCardell, Brunel, all those guys. And then when they spoke, you were like, yeah, right, exactly. We got to pick it up and get it going. Here's the thing. You got to dig deep now, Dan. You got to dig real deep if you're a Jaguar player. You got to look in the mirror and say, am I doing everything possible to make myself better, which will make my team better? I don't think they are. I don't think some guys are putting in enough work mentally. maybe even conditioning-wise.
Okay.
I think they're slacking a little bit, but if they really want to turn this thing around, it's going to have to come from within each and every individual player.
Well said, Tommy McManus. The eye in the sky doesn't lie, by the way. We'll take one more break. We'll come back. We'll talk about Tommy's coach in a special week for him last week. There he is, the man, the legend, Tom Coughlin. That and more live at Strings. It's Jags Report Live. Yeah!
This is Action Sports Jax, Jags Report Live from Strings Sports Brewery. Sponsored by Farrah & Farrah, the exclusive injury law firm of the Jaguars.
3, 2, 1.
Oh, it was a long time coming, but it was great to see right where he belongs. Tom Coughlin into the pride of the Jaguars. Hopefully the Pro Football Hall of Fame. I don't know what they're waiting for as we welcome you back here. Two Strings. We've got one of his former players who knows him better than anyone. Boston College.
Yeah.
Big part of the Jay Fund right here. He continues to give back. Jay was a teammate of yours.
Oh, yeah.
Obviously,
yeah.
Just a quick Coughlin comment from you.
Listen, that guy was all about winning. That's all he wanted to do, and he was committed to winning. He also always believed that the mind is stronger than anything.
Good night, everybody.
Thanks for watching Action Sports Jack's Jags Report Live from Strings Sports Brewery. Sponsored by Farrah & Farrah, the exclusive injury law firm of the Jaguars.